So thank you guys for coming to this presentation. Today we'll be talking about how to create substantial wealth from the booming real estate, Vancouver real estate market. My name is Gary Wong, and just a little bit about myself. I'm born and raised in Vancouver. I studied psychology and Mandarin at UBC, then worked in the corporate world for about 8 years. And then I got married and I went to business school. During that time, I got married and I was tutoring a child whose father was a builder. And he said, Gary, why don't you get your real estate license? Maybe I'll give you some homes to sell. So real estate was something I was always passionate about, but I never entered it because I was afraid of, my parents had put in me the fear that it's really competitive, you need networking skills and all that. So, with the MBA I felt confident, so I went into real estate. And, a couple of years ago, I met my millionaire mentor, and my life has taken off since then. Today we'll be discussing how what's going on in the real estate market, maybe give you some tips about real estate investing. One thing I learned in the past 5 years is that I thought I knew a lot about business until I went to business school. I realized I knew nothing when I entered business school. I came out of business school and did my real estate licensing. I thought I knew a little bit about real estate. Started working in the real estate world, I realized I knew nothing about real estate. And then I started working in the real estate world, I thought I knew a little bit about real estate investing. I met a veteran real estate investor, and I learned I knew nothing about real estate investing. So the good thing is, it's great to be at a point where you realize you know nothing about that topic. That's where you it motivates you to get to the next level. So the agenda for today, we're going to talk about the current market trends, the bidding war tactics, how to definitely negotiate in this booming market. Everybody knows what's going on in the Vancouver market. It's pretty crazy. The common question, age-old debate, rent or buy, and I'll go through that. Top five buyer mistakes made in a hot market. Top five seller mistakes made in a hot market. And then we'll cover, we'll also go into the financing aspect after that with Bai Jiang. And then we'll discuss some real estate investing basics. So this is what's going on in the Vancouver market. So March of 2016 in the Vancouver West, we have these prices are the HPI or home price index. Price means that's what a typical house costs in that area. So in Vancouver West, the home price index is $3,072,000, condos $635,000, townhouses $939,000, Vancouver East $1.2 million. Condos $390,000, townhomes $714,000. So I get these market stats, and then we see 571 listings, we see 221 sales, and then people don't really understand what that really means. Like, is it a good market? Is it a slow market? Is it booming or is it not? So in the real estate industry, we talk about something called absorption ratio. Basically, they take the number of listings divided by the sales in that month, and they look at, okay, so if there's 571 listings in March, 221 of them sold, it takes 2.6 months to clear the 571 listings. So it's called a 2.6 month supply. Same for condos, 722 listings, sold 683 sold, and it takes 1.1 months to clear the listings. So what does that number mean? So if it's 0 to 4.9, that's considered a seller's market. If it's 5 to 7.9, that's considered a balanced market. If it's over 8, that's considered a buyer's market. So you can see it's been a crazy seller's market for the west side. And then here, east side, 382, that's 1.8 months. 207. So interesting thing is condos, there were 207 listings in March, but 209 sold. So what does that mean? 207 listings were on the MLS, but there were two sales that were not on the MLS. So pocket listings are listings that a realtor might have that isn't placed on MLS. They're called exclusive listings as well. So they sold, but they were never on the MLS. So same for townhomes, 27 listings, but 32 sold. Okay, so the month supply 1.8, 1.0, 0.8. So basically if it's under 5, it's a seller's market. And if it's really close to 0, it's a crazy, crazy, crazy market. So here's other cities. I have all the cities, but I'm just gonna go through a few of them. So North Vancouver, you can see it's a 1.0 month supply for houses. That's a 1.1 month supply for condos. Townhomes, also 0.7. 1.4 million typical house, 400,000 for a typical condo, 734,000 for a typical townhouse. West Vancouver, 2.8 million, 822,000. And NA, basically they didn't have enough data to really determine that. Like there's all these like plus 28%, minus 2%, basically compared to last year, what were the percentages? So when I meet with my clients, I go, like if they're a numbers person, they really care about the numbers and stats, I go into more detail. But just to give you a brief, so typical house, 1.4 million, typical condo, 400,000, typical townhouse, typical house in Coquitlam, typical condo, and typical townhouse. So you can see that they're all like close to zero. It's like a crazy seller's market. What does this mean for buyers and sellers? It means like pros and cons. There are different things that I'll talk about. It's good for sellers in that they're able to sell their homes for record prices, but also if they wait, then their price, their home will be worth more. So, you know, I talk about in my book, when's the best time to buy or sell. I usually, the bottom line is when you're ready to buy and sell. It's great for buyers because whatever they buy, it's probably gonna go up very quickly, right? So rather than focus on the negative, like, oh, it was cheaper last month. Well, if you buy it now, it'll be worth more next month, so. So what are the like, most common question, like what's driving this market? What is it? So some economic fundamentals, the low currency compared to the US dollar. It was a bargain a couple years ago when the Canadian dollar was on par with the US a couple years ago. It was still a bargain for the Asians and mainland Chinese to come here and buy. It was still considered cheaper than buying a house in China. Low oil prices, that definitely caused the currency to dip even further. Foreign demand, so because the oil prices, a lot of people from Alberta are migrating to Vancouver. That was happening even when the oil prices were high. Like we get lots of migration from the eastern provinces, from Toronto and other eastern provinces. We have a lot of demand, not just from mainland China, but from all over Asia. Hong Kong, Taiwan, and then obviously because the currency is so low, US, Europe, and Middle East. A couple of years ago, the Dubai Prince came and bought the top two floors of Fairmont Pacific Rim, the two penthouses for like $40 million.
500, wasn't it 500? Was it?
40 million for, he bought both floors.
That was the son of Prince.
Yeah, one of the princes. One of the Dubai princes, that's
Prince
right. Maktoum. I don't know his name.
Maktoum.
You know him?
It's a long name. It's a really long name.
Yeah. So basically, investors is a bargain, and a lot of them, they park money. Vancouver is ranked top city in the world. So great place for people to park their money, right? It's a safe haven. Everybody knows that. Local demand. So people think it's all the foreigners, but there's actually a lot of local demand. Children wanting to live the same life as their parents. The like studies say that they want to own the house. They want to, yeah, there are a certain portion that want to live in Main Street and live in the hipster lifestyle and live in condos. But a lot of them still want to live the same life that their parents did in the house. They want to grow up in a house and that kind of thing. And the thing with the housing prices, it has increased the equity of the homes to the point where the parents can now downsize and then give help provide the down payment for their children. So the rich foreigners who have become PR or Canadian citizens in the past 20 years, So after 1997, Hong Kong left. A lot of people from Hong Kong came to Vancouver and settled, a lot of the rich ones. And then from then, and then the Taiwanese came as well during that time. And then, so we're not just talking about the rich people from like buying out of town, but we're talking about the ones who live here already. So there's a lot of demand, definitely. Low supply, sellers hesitant to sell because the market keeps rising. So people say, oh, if it's a hot market, why doesn't everybody sell? But the sellers are thinking like, if I sell now, I can make more 2 months later. I don't want to sell, but if I sell now, I can't buy because there's no supply. So there's a lot of hesitation for sellers to sell in this market. They don't know what's going on. The typical procedure is to sell and then buy. But in this market, it's buy and then sell. Because before in a normal market, you want to sell your house first, and then you have a couple months, and you go find a place, and then you buy a place. Because you don't want to carry the risk of having two mortgages. But in this market, because if you sell first, you might not be able to buy because there's no inventory, nothing good out there, right? So a lot of the sellers actually right now try to buy first. And then because they know that they'll have no trouble selling, so they buy first and then sell. Downsizing. So like I said, a lot of the people who are living in poorer neighborhoods, say East Vancouver was considered a poor neighborhood maybe like 10, 20 years ago, where people with low income jobs, janitors or nannies or whatever, they're living in East Vancouver and all of a sudden they're millionaires because their houses have appreciated to the point where, yeah, they're like $1 million. So they're sitting on gold mines, they sell, help their children with down payment, and they want to reduce property taxes. So some houses that were worth like $1 million or $1.5 million in Vancouver, all of a sudden they're $4 million. And then their property taxes skyrocket to like 15 grand a year. And a lot of them are seniors. So seniors on pension, so they sell their property to give the money to their children and they downsize their condo, right? So in this market, it's a bidding war everywhere. So my clients talk to me like, what are some strategies? How can I compete in this market? Bidding war tactics for buyers. Obviously a subject-free offer. So because a typical normal market, you can write, oh, subject to financing, subject to home inspection, subject to reading the title search, the property disclosure statement. And for condos, you can be like subject to reading the strata documents and all these things. Right now in this market, if you write a subject offer, a lot of times you will not win in the bidding war. So how do you prevent yourself? The subject clause is actually there to protect you, right? In case you want to walk away from the deal, like if you don't like the property, in case you don't get financing. So in financing perspective, make sure you just get pre-approval. Talk to Bai or any other mortgage broker. Make sure you have pre-approval. And then really common in the industry, not just in this market, but in a normal market when there's a bidding war, really common is to do a home inspection prior to writing an offer. So people go, well, like, that's like, what if I do the home inspection but I lose in the bidding war? Well, it's $400 down the drain, but consider it a cost of shopping for a home. Just like when you buy a car, you take your car, take the used car to a mechanic, you pay like $100 to check whether there's any problems, whether it's a lemon or not. You're buying a $500,000 house, $500 isn't too bad, right? You want to learn the seller's interests. You want to find out what the seller cares about. Are they looking to sell quickly, or are they looking to just sell and find a place to downsize, but they can't find it? So maybe they need 6 months to find their next home. So maybe you can use the dates to negotiate with the seller. Yes.
Is that what you use, Gary? Like when you first meet with a prospect, you try to find out about their interests.
Oh yeah, definitely. That's with the with a buyer. I do that. But then let's say my buyer says, "Hey Gary, let's go. I want to buy this house. I'm really interested in it." Then I would do my due diligence and call the listing agent and find out, what's the seller like? You know, are they a senior? well, what do they care about? Do they care about the price mainly, or actually they want to lease back? They want to sell their home, but they want to live in their home until they find a place. So maybe they want to rent it back, or maybe they want to sell their $3 million gold mine and just live in that place for, you know, $2,000 a month and rent for like a couple of years, right? And then depending on who the buyer is, they might not mind that, right? So I learned the seller's interest because there's ways of writing terms that would favor the seller's interest. Offer in writing, definitely no verbal offers. Show that you're serious. So very common in the industry in a seller's market is to write subject free offers with a bank draft. So subject free offers is common in a bidding war, but if you want to differentiate your subject free offer, here are some ways. Include a bank draft to show you're serious. Like, here's a deposit, Mr. Seller. Like, that's how serious I am. A letter of intent, I just did this a couple days ago. I encourage my clients to write a letter, a personalized letter, sign it, saying, oh, Mr. Seller, you know, we are like blah, 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 this is my job, and we're really interested in your home, we really like it. I wanna be your, you know, I'll take good care of your home, something like that, right? So we did a letter of intent, we also did a video, a letter of intent via video as well. So I got my clients to film themselves doing a small YouTube video, and then we took that, we uploaded it to YouTube privately, we got the link, we sent it to the listing agent, we forwarded it over to the seller, was really impressed. So that differentiates yourself. It made them, you want to be on their good side, right? When you're negotiating, you want any benefits. You know, if I could give them like flowers and a box of chocolates, I would have done that too. So write more than one offer. How does that work? So let's say you're in a bidding war, and be prepared. Like, you might write initial offer, and you might have to write another offer, like maybe half an hour later if you're bidding against other people. And then, so it's good. It's good practice. Don't focus on just writing one offer. Write more than one offer for the same deal, right? And then you can also, in a normal market, I usually tell my clients, there's no harm in writing multiple offers, like writing two offers for the same property. One offer has subject clauses. One offer has no subjects. But the one with no subjects, you're taking a risk. So risk equals money. So I'll buy your property for less, like, because I'm taking the risk. Because I'm bearing the risk, I will offer you less. In case something happens, like in case the home inspection turns out bad and I need to fork out $30,000, so I'm gonna offer you $50,000 less than what my subject offer is. But, so just giving them the option that you choose, right? Know your competition. So for buyers in this hot market, I talk to them and I say, let's not write an offer until the last minute. Let's find out who our competition is. Usually other buyers will be writing their offers at the last minute too, because they want to find out the competition too, how many offers were there. They also don't want the listing agent or the seller to take their offer and shop it. Shop it means they take offer number one and go to the other buyers and go, oh, offer number one was this price, can you beat it? Which isn't really fair, but sellers are the boss. If they want to do it that way, they can do it. It's legal. Know your market. So obviously, talk to your realtor. Find out how much the property is worth. Just because it's priced at $900,000 doesn't mean it's worth $900,000. It could be priced that way for a particular reason to generate multiple offers, bidding wars. So a property worth $1 million could be asking $950,000 for the purpose of generating the buzz, the frenzy. It's like the Boxing Day frenzy thing. Let your realtor play the game. So in negotiations, a lot of times it's really emotional. And I tell my clients, hey, just enjoy the process. It's a game. We got to play the game. We got to play the politics. We got to, you know, butter the listing agent up. We got to get favor. And sometimes we got to just play the game and not be so uptight. And it depends on the situation. It's context-based. But yeah, listen to your realtor and enjoy the process. For sellers in a bidding market, strategic pricing. Well, in a hot market, you don't want to just jack up your, let's say your house is worth $1 million, you don't want to just put it at 1.5 million because, oh, I'm the boss, sellers. So when I say seller's market, means sellers have the leverage. There's more buyers than sellers, so sellers get to choose. In a buyer's market, that means there's more houses, more sellers than buyers. Okay? For sellers, you have the control, you have the leverage, but doesn't mean you jack up the price to like 1.5 and overprice it. So there's actually a certain pricing strategy. Do you price it at market value? Do you price it slightly below? Do you price it way below market value? So there's strategic pricing that you gotta consider. And just because in a hot market, sellers, doesn't mean you cheap out on the marketing. You should still use high quality photography, videography, and floor plans. You shouldn't take pictures with your iPhone unless you're like a professional iPhone photographer or something like that. But I always outsource my photography to a professional photographer. Videography, not always needed, but if it's a place that would benefit from videography, I would definitely implement it. But also, some sellers don't want videography for their houses. They value the privacy of their home. They don't want everybody knowing what the insides look like. Floor plans, that's another thing. I usually get floor plans done for all the listings I get. Just, it's a value added. I do that. Create a Boxing Day frenzy. So what is a Boxing Day frenzy? Basically,
when all houses in Vancouver are
50%
off.
Yeah. Well, close. Anybody have an idea what a Boxing Day frenzy is?
No, but like his
Sydney,
idea.
Sydney, go ahead.
Price just under the, let's say, 25% off.
Yeah,
it
yeah.
It seems like a deal yeah. compared to like other people. Mm-hmm. But when people start coming, it's like, oh, they want it. I want it too, and then it goes up.
Close. Anybody else? Yes.
You want to create a lineup?
Yes.
You want to create a lot of attract a lot of attention so that
Perfect.
You get people competing against each other.
Exactly. So yeah. you want to say, okay, the house is listed. The house is listed on a Thursday. So the strategy is the realtors would put it on the market on Tuesday. It would be available to the public the public can see it on Thursday. Open house on Saturday and Sunday, and then they would take offers on Sunday night or Friday or Saturday or Monday night. So you're basically giving the public 2 days to see it, right? So that would create a Boxing Day frenzy. And then that would generate the crowd, the herd mentality. So when you go into when you go to a Best Buy on Boxing Day, everybody's reaching out for that iPad. You want to buy it all of a sudden because everybody wants it, right? So for real estate, people try to do that. Sometimes they minimize the two open houses to one open house. Sometimes they minimize the hours from 2 hour open houses to 1 hour open houses. So the purpose of that is to cram as much people into the house as possible. So when you go to an open house and there's 40 other groups inside, wow, everybody must want it. This must be like a hot product. And then it creates that bidding, that frenzy, right? So that's called the Boxing Day frenzy. And most realtors know how to use it quite standard, quite well. And then there's ways you can make it like, you know, like have a 1 hour open house, half an hour open house. You can have a 1 day, instead of having a 2 day open house, you can have a 1 day. You can take offers on a specific day right after the open house. It can be on a Sunday right after open house. So there's different ways to do it. Or you could, I've seen it done where they would create the lineup and then the listing agent would let only one group at a time in.
Oh,
so it's just
almost like waiting to get into an accident.
That's right.
Until they have a big heavy guy.
Yeah, that's right. Exactly. It's just like the restaurant, Steffo's downtown, right?
Oh, that one is always busy.
It's always busy. And then when you see the lineup, you're like, oh, it must be great. But when you walk by a restaurant and there's no lineup, you're like, you know?
Gary, oh, smart strategy. Watching,
yes.
Like real estate, I think
millionaire
listing LA.
Yeah.
Some of them would do like kind of not like house parties, but they
yeah.
would like have people come in.
Yeah.
And it would kind of like be a party with drinks and everything.
Yeah, yeah.
Is that another kind
yes.
of boxing?
Yes. That's creating the buzz.
Creating the buzz.
Yeah. So you want to you want people to come in and go, wow, you know, I went to that open house and they served us drinks, and it's all like, it's like going to the auto show and then you see the models there. The models don't help you buy the car. The models are just there, so you associate, oh, I see a model, oh, it's hot. Car, oh, hot, hot, hot. Oh, and then you all of a sudden have the association, oh, the car must be hot, right? So they associate, or like you go into a nice a house and then they have it staged with like expensive stuff. And then like, oh, this house must be luxurious because the furniture.
It's all in the psychology.
It's all psychological. It's all psychological. So yeah, it's really smart. Set an offer date and time. That's part of the Boxing Day frenzy. Let your realtor play the game. Because you want, like if you're the seller and your listing agent takes offers and there's 10 offers, you want the listing agent to play the game of like, oh, let's massage the bottom 5 offers and get them to the top. And then we'll try to massage the top 5 offers to get them higher. So it's like playing the game and playing the realtors against each other, right? So there's different strategies. Obviously, the listing agent will discuss it with the seller, which strategy the seller wants to use. You can even do, the seller can do it whatever way they want. They can actually, the seller can sit there and have all 10 buyers or all 10 buying agents stand there and like bidding war. Like have a sign and auction, like, I'll put 1.1 million, or I'll put 1.2. The seller can do whatever they want for taking offers.
Does but that actually happen?
It doesn't happen, but it's allowed, but just no one does it like that.
Okay.
It's allowed because the seller is the boss. They can do it however they want it. They can have the buyers come to the table and present the buyers themselves. Usually it's the buying agent presenting. Sometimes in real estate, you're allowed to present offers in person unless the seller specifically states they don't want offers in person. But the seller, if they allow it, then they usually allow the listing agent, the buying agent to present in person. Sometimes the seller will allow the buyers to come with the buying agent to present. It's up to the seller. The seller can do whatever they want. Negotiations in this market. So how do you negotiate? How do you negotiate at 5,000, 10,000? Well, if it's a seller's market, like you think as a buyer, I have no say, right? Wrong. Work with a realtor who knows how to play the game, because a lot of it's political. Not all realtors are the same. So if you're on the realtor's good side, sometimes you get some sort of favor, right? Some sort of favor. Get on the, like I said, get on the listing agent and seller's good side, letter of intent, a video, that helps. Learn the seller's motivation. Why are they selling? Is it a divorce? Is it like they want to get into another school? Are they downsizing? So if they're downsizing, maybe they don't want to get, like there's a lot of furniture they need to get rid of. Maybe you can take that off their hands for them. Maybe you can say, I'll throw in, I'll pay for your 1-800 got junk bill or something like that. Like learning the motivation, maybe they want to rent or they need a long time for, maybe they're moving like to another city, like relocating out of the province. Right? So learn about the seller's motivation and see if you can work your terms into a way that satisfies and makes a win-win situation. Write strong offers, no-brainer. Definitely write a strong price, the dates, a deposit. Deposit is typically 5% of the asking price, but it's very flexible. There's no rule. You can write $5 if you want, but obviously the seller will perceive that in a negative manner, or you could write a 15% and 20% deposit if you want, right? Terms that I mentioned that already. So get the accepted offer first. Worry about the small things later. So a lot of times I talk to clients and like they think like, oh, like the price is like, is it gonna include the furniture? Is it not including the furniture? But what about the dates? Like, I don't really, this date doesn't work for me. Like it's really hard. I tell my clients, just worry about the first step. Get the accepted offer first. You know, worry about the small things later. It's in the seller's best interest to complete. Nobody wants to go to court. Nobody, like you write a subject-free offer and you want to change the dates. Sellers, seller has the right to say, nope, I'm not going to change the dates, you know, and then they're not going to, the seller doesn't want to take the buyer to court, right? Nobody wants to go to the hassle of paying $5,000, $10,000 over like a $500 issue, right? Everybody wants to get the deal done. So get the accepted offer first, negotiate some of the smaller things later. Obviously it's case by case as well. Present, negotiate offers in person with the realtor if possible. It's easier to say no via email. It's harder to say no when you're face to face with the seller. If you're face to face with the seller, it's hard for them to have the poker face, especially if you do like letter of intent, a video, all these crazy things. They're not like sellers aren't very good actors, you know. They're emotional as well, and
very emotional.
Exactly. Age-old question: rent or buy? Is it better to rent or is it better to buy? So in this market, everybody goes, "Oh, it's too expensive. I should just stay renting," right? So I go through the pro. I go into this in a lot of detail in my book, the book on Vancouver real estate. I go through pros and cons of every season, that's about like when to buy and stuff. But for rent or buy, here are some pros. No fees, no strata fees, no property taxes, no mortgage. You don't have to deal with any of that. You just live in that place. No maintenance, so you don't have to maintain anything. Well, basic maintenance. So if your sink breaks, if your faucet breaks, if your stove isn't working, your fridge isn't working, you just call the landlord and ask them to fix it. Free amenities. It's great when you're able to live in a nice luxury condo, and the amenities cost the landlord like maybe $700 a month, but you, it's free. You know, so make use of it. You get the 24-hour concierge if you're living in a luxury building. You get the swimming pool, sauna, hot tub, gym, all that stuff, pool table, everything. No down payment. You don't have to save that 20% down or even 5%, 10%. Flexibility and relocation. Whenever you want to move, just pack your bags and go. Give the landlord notice and that's it, right? And a problem for landlords in this city is that they charge below market value rent because they want to rent their property to a tenant and never talk to the tenant ever again. Which in business, it's funny because I don't know any business that thrives where you never talk to your customer. Yeah, so that's interesting, below market value rent, but you can actually take advantage of that as a tenant, because you know they're like if the landlord is like out of town and they don't really care and they just want somebody paying part of their mortgage, you can often get away with paying below market value rent for years at a time, which is great. What are the bad things? What are the downsides of renting? Paying the landlord's mortgage. That's the most common. People say that, oh, well, I'm paying their mortgage. And you know, obviously, since you're paying their mortgage, you don't have equity in the property that you're living in. Location instability, meaning the landlord can kick you out at any time. You know, they want to move, they want to significantly renovate. You know, your children, if your children are going to a particular school, well, you might get kicked out and you might have to change schools. Landlord rules. Usually tenants have pretty much a lot of freedom when it comes to living in the apartment or the house, but landlord can implement certain rules. So obviously the tenant has to follow the strata bylaws. Yeah, go ahead.
Is it also true, Gary, like, isn't it like every, I guess this is just from business to business.
Yeah.
Or maybe like residential.
Yeah.
Is it true like every 2 years, the landlord has the right to increase the rent by like 400 or maybe like a certain percentage, but is it true like at the end of the contract they have the right?
It's usually 1 year, every year, but then actually if you give them 6 months notice, the thing with the rent increase, there's a rate set by the residential tenancy branch. So right now,
I can speak to that.
Yeah, go ahead.
That's what I do.
That's what you do?
Yeah, I rent people's homes for them, and actually I was asked the exact question today, and there's been some changes, but it's now 2.9% on the existing rental income. And if it, you can't go above that. If you do, your tenants can actually go back to arbitration and claim the money back from you. So most of the tenants are smart enough in the city to know you can't do that. And it's every year, only once a year. And you are not legally allowed to get rid of a tenant and get a new one in right after.
It's against the law.
Yeah, you can get in a lot of trouble with the Residential Tenancy Board, particularly if the tenant that's left is gone, and it's 2 months' notice, by the way.
Yes, right.
2 months' notice.
So it's a funny thing about the residential tenancy branch, because they've spoken at our office before, and they basically they had a long talk, an hour talk about what goes on, and what I got out of it was a lot of it is vague, a lot of it's in the gray. So there's a 2 month rule, or there's this rule or this rule, but when it comes to push comes to shove, it's gray. They could change their mind. Oh, well, they brought their lawyer here. Okay, we'll give them an extra 2 months, which happened to my client. We gave them the proper notice, blah, 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 and then they were supposed to leave, and they didn't leave. They brought in their lawyer, and arbitration said, okay, we feel bad for you. Stay another 2 months. It's very vague. Yes, bye.
So just to expand on that answer, so if you are in a month, like say you've got a 1 year term, and then you tick the box to actually end the term,
yep.
So you go month to month, you can only go say 2.9 as per the increase. But if you said fixed contract 1 year, you gotta renegotiate at that point, yep. Then you can bump it up
correct.
To whatever market
correct.
Rent is.
And it's just a very specific thing on your rental agreement.
Correct.
And
yes.
The standard residential tenancy agreement that the BC government give you does not have it in.
Yeah.
And so you have to have a very good contract.
Yeah. You know, I always I would encourage my clients to write addendums to their contract. And then after writing that contract, send a copy to residential tenancy branch and get them to provide approval in writing, so that if ever arbitration comes, that's not legal, it's not allowed. Well, you got the email from residential tenancy branch saying that's okay, right? So landlord rules, no parties after 10 o'clock or whatever, that's the bad side about renting. You don't own it, limited ability to renovate. You can't just do whatever you want in terms of renovation wise. Especially if you live in a home. Well, if you live in an apartment, obviously there are certain regulations, but if you live in a house and you want to add a big section or that kind of thing, you gotta talk to your landlord first. Buying, pros and cons. Buying, well, obviously when you buy a property, you have ownership. Obviously there's the equity when you're buying a property, you save equity into the property. There's the opportunity for the property to appreciate in value, and you take advantage of it. Whereas if you're renting, you don't take advantage of the appreciation. Flexibility with buying, you can take equity out in the form of a home equity line of credit, or a HELOC as it is known by. You can rent the whole place out, you can partially rent it, you can rent the basement if you live upstairs, or you can rent the rooms, you can do homestay. There's lots of options you can do with when you own the property. Buying cons, you have to save that big down payment to get a mortgage, and you're buying a liability. So what do I mean by a liability? Does anybody know what I mean when I say buying a liability? Yes, Adnan.
Takes money out of the pocket.
So if you've read Rich Dad Poor Dad, as some of you had, they talk about buying your house is not an asset, you're buying a liability. A liability means something that takes money from your pocket every month. And buying, yes, Sydney.
I have some friends that they think buying a home in Vancouver is an asset. Okay? So it is. It's an asset.
So it's an asset. It puts money in their pocket when they sell it.
Yeah.
Until they sell it, it's a liability.
No, it's not there's one friend, he just rents his house for some reason has almost 8 rooms.
Oh, see.
And he does homestay for every
single
room. So his mortgage is covered, plus he gets extra $2,000.
Sweet. So that would be an asset. And so we'll talk about more about investing and creative investing techniques later in this presentation. But generally, if you're buying the house to live in yourself, it's usually taking more money out of your pocket than it is giving you money, right? top five buyer mistakes made in a hot market. So in this hot market, number one, you're thinking everybody's afraid of a bidding war. So they think, oh, I'm paying over asking price. That's bad. So I'll give you an example of Point Grey Road. I was working with my builder client about a couple years ago, and I saw this prestigious house teardown in the most prestigious street in the whole, probably in the whole province.
Belmont Avenue?
No, it's Point Grey Road. Right. It's the most prestigious street, and it's most expensive price per square foot of land in the entire BC. So it's called Point Grey Road, and we saw this lot on there, and it's very rare that homes on that street go up for sale. It's tear down. It was worth, it was asking $3 million, and we went into a bidding war, and there were, we didn't find out how many offers until later, but my builder said, Gary, what is it worth? I said, I don't know, it could be worth 3.1 to 3.9, because to find out market value, we usually look at comparables. There are not many comparables in Point Grey Road. So I basically looked and I estimated it could be worth anywhere from 3.1 to 3.9 million, $4 million. And I said, just pay your max that you're comfortable with. So he put in 3.51, and the bank actually came back and appraised it at 3.51. So it was good. And so we paid 500 grand over asking. There were five offers, we won. And within a year, I helped them make $1 million. The property was worth 4.5 in a year. Now it's probably worth 8 or 9 million. So great investment for him. So yeah, not just because you're paying over asking price doesn't mean you're overpaying. And just because you're overpaying, it's not a bad thing. In a market that's going up 30%, let's say you pay 5% over asking, 5% over market value. 2 months later, your home's worth 20% more. That 5% doesn't really make a big difference. Not having financing. So in a hot market, I know some, not my clients, but some other realtors' clients, they went in with subject free offers, but they didn't have their financing in place, and they ended up having to forfeit their deposit, like 50 grand, 70 grand. So make sure you buyers should get their pre-approvals. Talk to a mortgage broker like Bai. And then not knowing when to write subject and subject free offers. So people think, okay, it's a hot market, there's bidding wars everywhere. Does that mean I have to write subject free offers all the time? No. When you're not bidding against anybody, let's say the property is not super well priced, and for some reason, not like there aren't like five offers. Let's say you are the first guy, and you're gonna make an offer, and there's no other offers. Why would you write a subject free offer? Why don't you write a subject offer, right? When there's a competition, then you want to make your offer more competitive. But when there's no competition, you could write subject offers, right? Obviously, you have to take the risk on. If you write a subject offer and then somebody else jumps in later, which happened with my client recently, she put in an offer, it wasn't her best price, but then somebody came in later because she thought, oh, well, we're not competing. But then because she took her time, a couple days later, somebody else jumped on board and all of a sudden multiple offers. So not knowing when to write subject or subject free offers. Waiting for the perfect home. Top five buyer mistakes. So waiting for the perfect home. I talk to my clients that, you're never gonna find your perfect home because even, first of all, I say that, let's say you find the ideal home. It meets 100% of all your criteria. But just because it's your perfect home now, a month later, you're like, oh, well, I don't really like this part. Then it's not perfect anymore. Right? Or 2 months later, or let's say a year passes and your life changes or your job changes and the location changes or you have a child or all of a sudden it's not the perfect home. Like, so people change. So to wait for the absolute perfect home is kind of...
It's a constantly moving target.
Sorry?
It's a constantly moving target.
Exactly. Cindy, did you have a question?
Yeah. I just want to ask. Is it rare in the real estate industry where, like, let's say an affluent person sees a home, it's not for sale, like they can buy it outright? Is that rare?
They can buy it outright?
That home not for sale, but it's beautiful and it's like their eyes, it's a perfect home.
Uh-huh.
But they want to buy it.
Yeah, and then?
Are they able to do that? Like, well, say, I want to sell
go to the seller and buy it?
No, yeah. They're not selling it though.
Oh yeah, they knock on the door and say, "Hey, homeowner, do you want to sell your house?" Homeowner can sell. Yeah, and then like they don't have to, you know, they don't have to use a realtor. They just get a lawyer in between and do the deal. They could do that. Obviously, there's risks for not using a realtor, but if they want to do it that way, sure. Yeah. So waiting for the perfect one. I usually tell my clients, "Hey, you're gonna find something that's about 80% of what it meets 80% of your criteria, and those are the ones that you should consider. If it meets less than 80%, chances are let's keep searching. There's lots that usually meet 80% or more. Because if you're waiting for the perfect home in a hot market, prices go up very quickly in a hot market. So houses right now are going about 25% to 30% a year. So if you're let's say you're like, oh, I'll just wait 2 months. Well, you have to calculate what that 2 months will cost you. 30% divided by 12, maybe about 2.5% per month. So wait 2 months is 5%. So 5% on $1 million is $50,000. So it's a $50,000 waiting. You lose $50,000 if you wait 2 months, right? Not doing your due diligence. So just because it's a hot market doesn't mean you like don't do home inspections at all, or you don't read the strata documents, or you just buy crazy, right? You gotta work with your realtor, make sure you do your homework, make sure it's the right property for you. Don't just buy it because you know everybody else is buying it. Top five seller mistakes in a hot market. Number one. Just because it's a hot market, like I said, seller's not the boss. They can't just sell their hoarder house and expect it to sell for top dollar. They gotta declutter, stage it. Like, they don't have to hire a staging company, but they should stage it themselves at least. Depersonalize so nobody wants to see, your baby pictures and stuff. It looks nice for buyers. Buyers might look at that, but it detracts or it distracts the buyer from looking at the house, right? So depersonalization is very important. They don't want to look at your Canucks memorabilia. They want to see how this house works for them. That's why developers in their presentation showrooms, they don't have like pictures of specific people or that kind of thing, right? They want the buyers to envision themselves living in that home. Number two, being cheap in the marketing. So, you know, like I talked about high resolution, professional photography, videography, floor plan. Don't be cheap. Don't just say, oh, house for sale. Like, you got to write a good description. Don't say, oh, great, great house in a great neighborhood. That's a mistake. Number three, pricing it too low or too high. Obviously, if you price it too low, let's say your house is worth $1 million. You price it at $500,000. Yeah, you're gonna get a ton of offers, but the people just have to the buyers just think, well, if I'm in a bidding war with three other buyers, I just need to beat the two other people or three other people. So they'll try to they don't wanna pay market value, like $1 million. They might just offer 550, 600, 650, and then you might just get offers that are below market value. Pricing too low. It's sometimes just like it confuses buyers as well. Like, is this a joke? Or what's going on? Pricing it too high, obviously, you want the Boxing Day frenzy. But if you price it way too high, you're just like you're being too arrogant or overconfident, right? Well, obviously, go ahead.
I see like some articles on the Huffington Post where it's like it sold over like let's say.
Yeah.
Market value. Yeah. Is that because it's too high?
Is it just the sold over market value?
Yeah, like a huge number.
Yeah. So it also depends on like, so if it's Point Grey Road, like it's there's nothing like it. If there's nothing like it, there's no competition, you can charge a premium. Right? There's a reason why it costs like $500 a night to stay at Shangri-La. You know? There's nothing like it. Nobody else can compete with Shangri-La. So Therefore, they are able to charge significantly higher than the market range, right? So how is this same thing? If you're like the only one with the killer view and everything else around you doesn't have it or blocked with trees and yours has this unobstructed view, then you're able to capture and command a higher price. Could be over 50% over market value. Yeah. Not negotiating dates. So seller mistakes is, you know, because you're the boss, you should set the dates according to what works for you. You don't want to just, you know, like, because it's a hot market, it's not easy to find a place to buy. So if you give yourself too little time, then you're, you know, you're at a disadvantage, right? You might end up being forced to rent or live in Airbnb or whatever for the time being. So make sure you give yourself enough time to find a place to buy if you're moving. Not buying before selling, I talked about that. So you don't want to sell your property and then find that there's no inventory, or you're forced to buy some property that you don't like because you didn't negotiate the dates. So in a hot market, chances are I recommend clients to buy first before selling, but they're like, oh, well, what if I get stuck with two mortgages? You won't. Talk to your realtor. If your home is decent, it's not like a hoarding house, or it's not a grow up, or it's not a piece of junk, then you know, you have no problem selling it. So yeah, not buying before selling. Okay, so before I go into the real estate investing basics, I'm gonna pass the presentation over to my great friend and mortgage broker, Bai Jiang, who's gonna talk to you about a little bit about mortgages and financing.
Good evening, my name is Bai Jiang. I'm a mortgage broker with Dominion Lending Centers, as well as an organizer of a meetup group called Passive Income Through Real Estate. Started up that about 4.5 years ago as a group, from 300. It's now over to 2,200, by far the largest in Vancouver. So thanks, Hassan, for inviting us to guest speak, and Gary, you did a great job with regards to giving an overview of the trends. So I'm gonna ask you, I'm gonna take you through the process of investing and how to actually build a portfolio and some of the misconceptions with regards to that. So who is investing in real estate already? Okay, cool. Are any of you encountering problems with financing, or what's stopping you from taking the net, growing it further?
What's stopping me from growing it is the Vancouver market, just to,
okay.
And because I need the rental income to be able to cover the mortgage.
Yes.
And for most of the properties I'm looking at, that's not.
Okay.
So that's what's stopping me.
Okay. What about some of the other folks that are investing already? We can cover some of that as part of the presentation as well. Okay, so just a little bit about how I got into my business of mortgage brokering. Actually, when I came here from China with my family when I was fairly young, 6 years old, we came here with nothing, and parents just told us to work really hard. My parents, they busted their butt. First generation immigrants. My mom worked the equivalent of 8 shifts a week. So Monday to Friday, she would be a seamstress. Friday night to Sunday night, dishwasher. My dad worked in the restaurant business 7 days a week, no vacation. So we kind of learned to grow up pretty quickly, not asking for too much, but really working hard. So we worked hard through school. Got a good job afterwards, and rose through the corporate ladder. I did quite well. And sometimes stuff happens. You go through life and decisions are made without your control. So I actually went through a pretty big downsizing in 2010. I went to a meeting with my management and they showed me the new org chart and I said, where's my team? It was going to disappear in about a year's time. So that was probably the biggest, hardest thing in going through that process, in a sense. that you work really hard for something, and yet at the same time, you didn't have control of the situation. So who is working for somebody right now? Who's an entrepreneur? So as entrepreneurs, we want to work hard, and we have this goal and dream that we want to go after. Sometimes, like with the best of intentions, we go after it 100%. Sometimes it works, sometimes it doesn't. It's through the times when it doesn't that we fight through that adversity and take ourselves to the next level. And we find out what works and what doesn't, and keep on going, just going after it. But through that process, there may not be a lot of stability, right? Who feels that roller coaster ride of being self-employed? Because there isn't, like, there's no pension set for us, you gotta basically fund it. So when I left my company, luckily I had invested in real estate 13 years prior. So ever since I started working, I started investing in real estate. And that was what allowed me to build that that foundation in place. Even though I worked hard, like at the end of the year, I'd be doing like top performer class level. The pie is only so big for everybody to be up. So if you enjoy working for yourself and going after your dreams and goals, then your rewards are basically limitless, anything you can go after. But having that stability, especially once you start a family, is going to be very, very important because stuff happens. So what I'm going to talk about is how to actually start investing. And Vancouver market is quite different right now, just because the pricing is very, very high. And so I'm just going to go through some of those misconceptions, in a sense that you might be thinking, you know, I need a lot of down payment in Vancouver. Gary is showing us average homes of 1.2 million plus, 20% down in that situation, 240. If you're just starting off, pretty hard to get into the market, right? I need a lot of income. Big mortgage, big income. So, but I'll show you it's actually easier than you think, okay? Lowest rate is the best. While rate is important, there's another factor there to keep in mind. So not all mortgages are created equal. As you build your portfolio, you might be thinking, I can't get any more mortgages, or I can't get any more properties. I'll explain how you can overcome those hurdles. And insured mortgage, is it a good option or bad option? So I'll go through that example as well, and when you may want to use that to actually grow your portfolio. Okay, so I need a lot of money to start investing in real estate. Not really. Most people, when they think about real estate, they think I have to invest in my backyard. True, Vancouver is a great market, but you're also seeing that push going eastward as well, because Vancouver pricing is so high right now. It's creating, over the next 25 years, so by 2041, Greater Vancouver area is gonna have another 1 million people here, okay? Where are they gonna fit everybody? The only way is to densify. So when we talk about fitting all those people, it's not just in Vancouver, but the Greater Vancouver. So you have to look at densification, and wherever there's SkyTrain stops or future light rail transit stops, that's where the majority of the growth is going to be. So you already see that with the Brentwood Center. You're seeing that with Oak Ridge, Cambie. Everything is just expanding based around SkyTrain stations. Okay, that's where the densification is going to be happening. For those that don't want to be living in condos or townhouses, they're starting to move eastward because they want the space and the land. Pushing out to Maple Ridge, Abbotsford, Chilliwack, that's all expanding. with the Portman being twinned, you're actually getting more accessibility to those areas. Earlier this week, on Tuesday, I drove out to Chilliwack. It just took me about 55 minutes to go from Burnaby all the way out to Chilliwack. That was probably about 80 plus kilometers in 1 hour. So that's pretty good. When you can actually buy for a $400,000 property on Chilliwack versus buying 1.4 here, it's a bit of a kind of a balancing game in terms of what's more important. The way the current market conditions are within Vancouver, it's basically created made a lot of people instant millionaires, especially if they bought it a long time ago. They basically, if they've got a home that's say $1.4 million, they sell it, they got the cash, move out to Abbotsford, Chilliwack, and Maple Ridge, you can still get $400,000 or $500,000. Then you got about $900,000 to play with in terms of the savings that you can start investing. So if somebody has that, they then are more financially independent, then they can have choices. They don't necessarily need to be working all the time, or if they got a pension, then they can kind of scale back, spend more quality time with the family, volunteer or travel, whatever it may be. It's more a better quality of lifestyle. But once they sell out of Vancouver and they move somewhere else, it's pretty difficult for them to buy back into Vancouver because the appreciation out in the valley is not going to be the same as Vancouver. So that's a choice that they're going to have to make. But in each of those communities, there's a lot of amenities being made available now. So they don't necessarily need to come to Vancouver for kind of day-to-day type of activities. So if we look at, do you need a lot of down payment? No, you don't. If you there's properties available even within Greater Vancouver area that's $200,000 as a condo. Buy that as a purchase, 20% down, and that'd be $40,000, and we treat this as a 5-year term. So in basically on cash flow basis, if you get $100 per month, and over 1 year you get 1,200, 5 years you get 6K, okay? Mortgage pay down over the first 5 years is basically about 10%, 10-12%. So you basically, you have a tenant that's acting really as an employee for you. They're going out and working every month, they're coming back and they're giving you rents, which includes principal plus interest component to it, right? So that principal component is paying down your mortgage on a monthly basis. And over 5 years, we'll treat that your mortgage was $160,000 to start. So in 5 years, your balance would be $16,000 less, okay? As well, even on an appreciation of 2% a year, that would give you 10% roughly in 5 years, that's 20K. So when we add 6K plus 16 plus 20, that's 42. Your initial investment is 40,000. Your return is 100% in basically 5 years time, right? Approximately compounded, it'd be about 16-17% a year. But you can't get that in the stock market with all the volatility. You've invested that money in the stock market, even if you have 1,000 shares of a company, somebody who has 1 million shares floods the market pre-market before you can even decide. You have no control whatsoever. At least with cash flow properties, even in a market where it starts going down, you can kind of ride through the wave because you've got cash flow during that time. Right? You decide when to basically dispose of the property. So even in a situation where, let's just say there's no cash flow and there's no appreciation, so 5 years later, it's still at $200,000, you're gonna get $16,000 just from the mortgage pay down. That's 40%. So 8%, 6-8% per year compounded, guaranteed. As long as you do your job in terms of making sure there's no vacancy, then you're going to be earning that. Any questions with that? Yes.
$100 a month cash flow become $6,000?
Sorry?
How does $100 a month cash flow become $6,000?
So, $100 a month, $1,200 in 1 year, 5 years, $6K.
Oh, 5 years.
Yes. We treat this as a 5 year term, mainly because 5 years, if you try and that's when the mortgage pay down starts really, it doesn't pick up at 5 years, but once you start going to 10 years, that's when it starts picking up. But if you try and get something that's like a 1 year or 2 year, you won't see the really big uplift in appreciation yet. So if you want trying to get like refinance in a couple of years, you might not be able to pull much out. So treat it as a 5 year term investment wise. Yeah, because you don't know what's going to happen in 2 years. It might start going down, right?
So you said total gain is 42,000.
Yes. Yep.
This is a $2,000 difference. How can I return the
100? The 2,000 divided by the 40 is the 5%. Like,
1,000 divided by 40.
Like you're right here.
Yeah.
So 6 plus 16 plus 20 is 42.
Yeah.
So you're saying where's the difference? This is your initial investment.
Yes.
Yes. So your gain is actually like you're doubling. In that situation, like your 42K is your return. Yes. So in 5 years' time, you have that much equity available. So at that time, I'll go into the next slide afterwards in terms of how you can actually really like supercharge your portfolio. Okay. So I'm going to get into the power, like through this. This is the supercharge. Okay, this is what you got to pay attention to. So if you start with just buying that first property, okay, and all you do is just add $100 into your savings account every month, okay, when you start off by year five, you'll have enough equity to actually buy the next property. Okay, that $100 per month kind of adds factors in the increase in potential price at that time because you're not buying 200 through the same price throughout. So there's going to be appreciation along the way. But if you take that every 5 years, you have enough equity to basically refinance and then buy another amount, you're doubling along the way. So if you do this for 25 years, your initial investment of 40K would turn into 1.6 in 25 years, all by itself. Okay? So by 25 years at that time, you're onto your 32nd property. Okay? Just through that doubling effect from your initial investment. Yes, Zingy?
So you have 32 properties by the end?
Or yes. Yeah, you're buying your 32nd.
Well, like you have 32 from all together? Or
yeah, yeah.
On?
You're onto your 32nd. So if you start off, say, when you're 20, by the time you're 45, you're onto your 32nd. You give it another 5 years to get to 50, you would be onto your 64th. Just from that initial, because it becomes exponential afterwards, right? So you're always in this situation refinancing the 80%. So we don't know what the rules are going to look like 25 years down the road. So this is what we can just project right now. However, over time, what you can still get to 1.6 by starting to pay down your mortgages too. This is equity. That's all it is. So imagine if you have everything paid off, and instead of needing 32 properties, but you only need maybe even you know, just 10, but it's worth 200,000. 10 free and clear properties, that's $2 million right there. So we don't need, or even 8, you'll still hit 1.6. You don't need to make it complicated. In a sense, the larger your portfolio, the more management you have to do. Like Vicky, you're in the business. So in this way, it's less is more at that point where it's free and clear, right? So this, imagine if you were getting, for this condo, $1,000. Okay, $1,000 and you got free, 8 properties free and clear, that's 8,000 positive cash flow for you, passive income. So most of us right now, who's focused on, the only way that they're getting income is active income. So active income is when you're trading your time for the dime. So you only get paid when you actually go to work. Who's in that situation? Yeah. So passive income is where it basically, it's working for you when you're not working, or when you're sleeping, when you're on vacation, you're in a washroom, whatever it may be, it's working for you. So some of you guys are, like Gary mentioned, Kindle publishing ebooks and stuff like that. So that's where leverage, like once you create a product, there's leverage after that. So every additional sale that you get, you could be sleeping, you could be driving, whatever, that's passive at that point. So the idea is to not always just focus on active income, because you can only scale so much, okay? Get your active income working for you such that you use your active income to buy assets for you that will generate you passive income, okay? So through that passive income, you want to build enough assets such that it can cover off your daily expenses. So once you've got your daily expenses covered, then whatever's left over, inject that back into your active business to generate even more income to buy more assets. So it's the whole rich dad, poor dad cycle, right? So that's the whole idea, so that it can be making your money work harder for you. That's the whole goal, so you can have that balance, right? Who works a lot better when they don't have to think about their finances? It's a lot of stress, right? Right, because you're always like, you get done with whatever you're working on, project, and then you're thinking, okay, I spent so much time working in the business, I didn't work on the business to be able to make sure that the pipeline is full. Right, then you gotta worry about next month and the month after that. Who gets worried about that? Right. So having something like this kind of smooths things out so that you've got a base that's growing over time. Does this make sense? Yeah. So if you have greater appreciation, it's going to go even faster. If you have, you know, zero, you have less, then it slows down. But this is kind of the idea. Okay. So I need a lot of income. People think you need a lot of income to be able to invest. It's not true. Okay. On $30,000 worth of income, okay, you're buying a rental property. So let's say it's a $450,000 purchase. So you're putting 25% down. You can even do 20% if you want to. $2,000 rent, okay? $3,000 in taxes, $100 in heating. You could buy one property, okay? And you're qualified for that, and you can keep on buying as long as you're only restricted by your down payment, right? There's no, you buy 4 properties, $1.8 million in terms of assets, $1.35 in mortgages. As long as you have, everybody's capped by 2 things with regards to buying property. Number 1 is their down payments, and number 2, their ability to qualify for financing. Qualifying for financing is actually easy part. Actually, when you're buying a property, what's harder, down payment or financing?
Down payment.
Depends on the situation. The bank's giving you.
I don't think either of them are easy.
Depends. Bank's giving you 75 to 80% of the money that you need to buy it. So you just need to come up with the 20 or 25%. And you might be thinking, well, I don't have that. Well, you don't have to have that. Somebody might have that for you. So if you come across a good deal, and it makes sense and it's going to make money, the money will find you. So you don't have to be, you don't have to worry about the money part. The money, find the deal first, okay? And if I have a good team, you either need, there's a book I read from Stefan Arniel. He's a Winnipeg investor, done really well. I wrote a book called, I think it was called...
Did you do a recent seminar here?
Yes, he did, okay, yeah. Is it something money
people
deal?
Money.
Yeah, people money deal. Yes. You need to have two of those. If you have two of those, you'll find the third, no problem. But the key is find the deal first. Find the deal, you have a team that helps you out, the money will come to find you. So that's how you're gonna get further ahead. Because the things that Gary is talking about in terms of 10, 20% increases, the real estate is like kicking everybody's butt in a sense of how much growth there is relative to somebody working. Okay, imagine you're working, you still gotta pay taxes and all the other expenses before you can actually, versus real estate. Right? Real estate, you can scale. Your job, you can't scale. So, who thinks lowest rate is the best? Yeah, it's important, but not the most important. Okay, there's other factors that come into it.
Lower
pricing is important, but I'll show you another thing that you should pay attention to. Maybe you could be able to borrow more instead of like putting less down payment. That might be a factor. So it's all about the terms. Maybe a longer amortization, so that allows you to qualify, or maybe allows you to count more of the rental income to help you qualify. So all these factors, maybe there's a combination of a mortgage with a line of credit where as you pay down the balance, automatically becomes available line of credit space you can use for the down payment for the next place, right? So all these factors, but so not all mortgages are the same. So I'll show you a couple. So TD offers for a rental, say a really good rate, 259 for a 5-year fix, really good. But you see some other higher ones like 279, 3.09, why would somebody want to go with that? At the bottom, comes down to what is the max mortgage that you can qualify for. TD would only give you 376 in this situation. Coles can give you 657. Van City can give you 703. For the same property. So which one would you prefer? Even though you have to pay a little bit more, you write off that interest anyways, right? Go, terms are more important. It's still cheap money. It's very cheap money. If paying a higher interest rate allows you to earn 20% a year, okay? And the difference is only 0.5 in this situation, what do you want more, right? So you need to focus on this. So rates are important, but may not be the most important because it's all about higher loan of value means higher return on investment. Okay, so I can't get more mortgages. Most lenders are capping you at about 4 or 5 properties. Some will go up to 16 doors. Some don't really care. As long as you have 5 max with them, they don't care what you have in terms of your portfolio. So where we actually learned how to do this was we had an investor come to us with 30 properties. He said, I got 30 properties, all done with the branch. I can't get any more. And I said, yes, you can. Here's how we got on his 31st. And just last year, we got him his 40th under personal name at 3% bank rates. So he can continue growing because he has options in terms of getting his building his portfolio. You either can qualify by yourself, that's a preference because you keep everything for yourself, or you have to bring in a joint venture partner to qualify in that situation. Then you give up equity like
20-30% in that situation. So even if you had to pay slightly higher rates, you're still better off trying to get keep everything yourself as you're starting to build your portfolio. And even like B lenders, which is, there's like 8 banks, and then there's private, really expensive. Somewhere in the middle is B, which is could be 1-2% higher, but it gives you the flexibility to grow your portfolio. So if you got a property that's really cash flows, you can afford to debt service, then do that instead of giving up equity in that situation. So at some point, you're gonna probably need to be, as you grow your portfolio, you're gonna cap by the down payment that you have. So let's just say it's all gone. Then you're gonna find out, well, how am I gonna get it? So you got to bring in partners to help provide that funding for the down payment, as well as mortgages you might no longer qualify for. So going back to that client that I was mentioning, his 40 properties was in a situation where he didn't have a job. All of his income was from his rental. So he has no job whatsoever, no T4. It was all rental income. And we still got him 3%.
And that's T4. Wow.
Yeah, no T4, no job. So, or you go commercial financing. At some point, your portfolio will get big enough that you go to multiple units. So when you go anything larger than typically 4 units, you're going to be looking at a multifamily in that situation. And commercial financing, where they just look at the property itself and not you as much on the individual side. So the property, it's self-sufficient, basically carries all the expenses, then you're going to be okay. Okay. And private lenders is another option, depends on what you want to do. And as Gary is going to go through some of the fix and flip options, we can talk about how something like that can play a role in allowing you to get the financing. Okay, I should not get an insured mortgage. So anytime you have to put, you're putting less than 20% down, you're gonna pay CMHC or Genworth or Canada Guarantee a premium for the mortgage to insure it. Who does not wanna pay that? Or who has bought a property with less than 20% down? Yeah, and you have to pay the mortgage, the insurance on it. It's not a small amount. If you up to with 5%, you have to pay 3.6% as a premium, which you'll never get back. So you might be thinking, well, why should somebody do that? Well, I'll show you. So if you had an option to buy a property where you're going to buy $400,000 property, and your down payment in that situation, 20% down, is going to be 80K, and your mortgage 320, your mortgage payment is roughly about 1,200 bucks. So over the course of 5 years, there's no cash flow. You're basically every month giving money out, right? As there is a mortgage pay down, but that's from you, okay? There's appreciation of 2%. So at the end of 5 years, you're gonna gain $7,000 net. And kind of your return is about 8.85% in 5 years. So that's like a percent something a year. Is that a very good return? No, right? So there's another way. So let's just say we're gonna put 5% down instead. Okay, assuming that you can qualify, we're gonna put 5% down. So our down payment is only gonna be $20,000 to buy the home. Okay, so bigger mortgage, pay the insurance premium, bigger mortgage payment as well, $500 difference. So even more capital outflow from a cash flow perspective. Okay, mortgage pay down, and then you got appreciation. So in 5 years, you're actually down. You're losing about 10% because everything's been going out. So where am I heading with this? Where I'm going with this is, we're actually gonna, with the remaining money that we have, that 60K, we're actually gonna buy a property instead. Okay, we're gonna buy a $300,000 property, and we're gonna have a mortgage payments, you're gonna have your rent, and you're actually going to have some cash flow from it too. Okay? So even in, you're going to have $200 cash flow in this situation. So you're going to have mortgage pay down, you're going to have your appreciation, and you're actually going to get 120% in 5 years from that property. So when you average the two, you combine them together between these, you're actually buying, you've got a total value of about $700,000 in terms of the purchase price, as well as a bigger mortgage, but the amount that you use for down payment is still 80K. And through the process, as you combine everything, you're actually ahead further by 70K in 5 years' time, just by having that rental property in the portfolio. So your return is close to 88% versus 9% in 5 years. So this is a good way to approach it. Does that make sense? So when Gary nods, I'm thinking he's, hopefully I impressed him. Thank you guys.
Okay, yeah, thanks Bai for the amazing presentation. I really like the last point where it's like, you know, I talk about that with my clients too. Like you can pay 5%, you can put your 5% down and you pay a mortgage insurance of 2 to 4%. But let's say you save 60K, and then let's say you invest that 60K in any investment vehicle that brings you 20% return. So you have to pay interest of, you know, 5% or a little bit more interest, but all of a sudden you can get a return of like 20%. You might as well take that money out and invest. So I know a friend who told me about 5 years ago, he's like, I want to put as low down payment, as little down payment as possible, because the money I save, I'm going to invest in the stock market. So he invests in index funds and he gets like 13% return or whatever. So that made me realize that concept back then. So I'm going to continue on with that. I know we had some questions during the little break. We'll go through a FAQ at the end and we'll take questions there, because I know one of the questions was, you know, in this market, how do you find a good realtor? And we'll talk about that. But real estate investing basics, I'm gonna take his Bai's presentation and kind of dumb it down a little bit and make it, make it very simple for you to simple to understand. Okay, real estate investing basics, there's two C's. It's either capital gains or cash flow. Okay, two things. So capital gains, this is a basic overview. So capital gains, you can buy and flip. So you buy a property that's below market value and then you flip it. Assignments, you can buy it and then you know the market went up, so you assign it to somebody for a higher price. You basically sell your contract. So you buy a property for $1 million, suddenly the market goes up to 1.1, and then you sell the contract to another buyer before the completion. Completion is when you actually pay the seller. Before that completion, let's say you complete in 3 months, but the property went up 100,000 in that 3 months. Before the 3 months is up, you sell your contract to a buyer number two who pays you the $100,000 lift, the profit. And buy and flip is very common in a hot market. It's not very common in a normal market. So just be aware of that. We can go into more detail about like the pros and cons and that kind of stuff. And when I sit down with my clients and I go through a consultation, I look at their risk tolerance and then I see which strategy works for them. There's the buy, rehab, and flip. Rehab means renovate the property, like a property's like looks like a dump. So you buy it at definitely below market value because it looks like a dump. You renovate it and then definitely at that time after you renovate, it appreciates and it's appraised at a higher value, then you flip it. So obviously, again, try to buy below market value. And then renovation, there's certain areas that you renovate. You don't just renovate the entire house. Certain areas add more value than others. As you've watched on TV, HGTV tells you, renovate this, renovate that. And you can end up spending a lot more than what you'll get out of your return. So you can upgrade your flooring to marble if you want, but if you might spend 10 grand on you might spend 20 grand on flooring, but it might increase your property by only 10 grand. Or you might want to, you know, there's like a lot of useless renovations that you do, like, you know, changing the light fixtures to chandeliers, or you want to, like, Swarovski crystals, or you want to, like, your backsplash is like silver plates or something like that. Or like, there's a lot of people who think if they just make their place look spectacular and they renovate every single thing to like the highest quality, they think it'll pay back good returns. That's not true. The three key areas to renovate is the kitchen, the master bedroom, and the bathrooms. Those are the three areas. Once again, kitchen, master bedroom, and the bathrooms. Those are the three key areas, because that's usually what buyers look at. And they want that emotional. Buyers buy based on emotion. Investors buy based on numbers. So you're selling it to a buyer who will, you want to touch their emotional side. So that's why you touch the kitchen, where they usually get really impressed with, the master bedroom, where they will spend most of their time, and then the bathroom, which is very important to them as well. Then there's the buy, rehab, and refinance. So it's very simple. You buy $1 million house, you take an $800,000 mortgage, 80%, you have a $200,000 down payment, and then you spend $100,000 to renovate the property, and then after renovations, the property is worth $1.5 million, and then you refinance for $1.2 million. I'll go into more details later on that. Pre-sales is another form of getting capital gains through real estate. You buy a property during their pre-sale period, developers sell their properties, sell the floor plans basically to people, and people buy it, and then it'll complete in 2 years, then they sell the contract before it completes. Or you can wait until it completes and then they flip it. Cash flow, talk about when Bai talks about cash flow, you're basically looking at income minus your expenses equals profit, your cash flow. There's also ways to increase rent. Short-term rentals, furnished, bundled services. I go into that a lot more in my book. I'll just explain this briefly. So if you're not getting the cash flow that you want, let's say the rent in that area is low compared to the price you have to pay. Well, you can always do Airbnb, or you can do short-term rentals, or you can furnish your apartment or your house and then charge it a premium. Bundled services, what I do is I encourage my clients, when you rent, try to include services. There's a reason why Shangri-La charges $500 a night and Best Western only charges $150 a night. Well, it's the same room, but different quality bed, and like they provide concierge services and all these things. If you just add services to your rental property, you can increase the rent. You can maybe like, let's say when you go to a Japanese restaurant and they have an all-you-can-eat, they know you're not, they charge you 20 bucks, they know you're not gonna eat 20 bucks worth, majority-wise. They've done the numbers, but they say to you all-you-can-eat so that you have the perceived value that you're getting more. Just like when you buy, you wanna buy the TSN sports channel from Shaw, the channel itself probably costs, if you buy the channel itself, it's like 20 bucks or 16 bucks. But then they'll throw in all these useless channels to make you have the perceived value that you're getting a lot more. So they'll throw in like 100 useless channels that nobody really watches, and then they'll say, oh, it's 25 bucks, you know? So it's the strategy is called bundling. So it's, you know, yeah, go ahead, Tina.
Yeah, I think a common service is like they have a dishwasher or not, like a laundry, like in-house laundry.
Yeah. Yeah, so if you can like bundle your services, let's say like when you rent your property out and you just say, let's say your utilities cost you about 100 bucks a month. You charge the tenant $150 on top of the rent and you say all utilities included. Well, you're making $50 a month every month, right? So, but then they have the perceived value. Wow, I don't have to set up my own bank, my own hydro account. I don't have to set up my own gas account or like, you know, terracing gas and stuff. Sorry?
TV.
Yeah, exactly. So I also include, I encourage my clients to include internet, TV, utilities, you know, maybe offer services like free house cleaning once every quarter, something like that. It costs you only like 20 bucks, like, no, house cleaning maybe 50 bucks every quarter, but you're charging them an extra like 100 bucks a month. You know, when you do the numbers, it's profitable. Okay, so let's go through the buy and flip example. So I'm gonna go through the buy and flip example. So this is a true example. This is exactly what it was worth back then. Dunbar House, 33 by 122 foot, 4,026 square foot lot in July of 2015 was worth about 2.1 to 2.2 million. 3 months later, no, four months later, same lot, worth 2.6 to 2.7 million. Straight flip. So you complete on the property in 2015. So you buy, let's say you buy in July, and then you you put the completion date in August, so that's when you pay the seller, and then you sell it in November. That's a straight flip. You wait until you complete, and then you flip it. Assignment is you tie up the property, so you say, okay, I'll buy it, but you want a completion date in November. But before November, in October, some buyer wants to buy that contract from you, and they want to buy it for 2.5 million. Why? Because they think they can flip it for, they think it'll go up, so they think it'll go up 2.6 or whatever. They buy from you for 2.5, you know, so it's win-win. That's called assignment.
Gary, did you hear about that house in, like, I think it was on Shaughnessy or Point Grey? It was like this little, really, really little house.
Yeah.
Apparently, just that sold for over like $4 million.
Yeah.
Did you hear about that?
I hear lots of crazy stories. Houses selling for over $1 million, like $1 million over asking, and
you know. It's like old, like really old and like.
It's in Shaughnessy though, right?
Shaughnessy.
Totally different.
Dunbar, no, it was in Shaughnessy.
Shaughnessy?
Right.
Yeah. You'd be surprised. Okay, so this 33 foot lot in Dunbar right now, probably worth $3 million. A 33 foot lot on Point Grey Road, at that time, like when I was working with my builder client at that time, it was like a 33 foot lot facing the water, maybe $5 million. Now it's worth like $12 million. So yeah, size is not, like I said, most expensive street in all of BC, different. Buy, rehab, and flip. Pretty simple, like example, East Vancouver house, you can buy for $1.3 million. You spend $200K on renovations. You make it look like a brand new house, list it for $1.7, you probably sell it in this market. Buy, rehab, and refinance example. So let's say a Surrey home, market value is $800,000. It wouldn't be a complete, it wouldn't be like a teardown. It'd be pretty decent. Mortgage, 80%, so it'd be $640,000. You put a down payment of 20%, $160,000. Your rehab cost would be $200,000. Let's say you do a really good job. And then after repairs, after your rehab, it's worth $1.3 million. And then what you do is you go to the bank and you ask them to appraise it and give you refinancing. And then all of a sudden they give you 80%, $1.04 million. So you take the mortgage that you get at the bank, use the new mortgage to pay off the old mortgage. So you take your $1.04 million minus the $640,000 from the other bank, and then equals $400,000. And then you have to minus the $200,000 that you spent to renovate it. Plus you have to minus the $160,000 for your down payment. And then you get $40,000 left, cash left over. Plus you still have $260,000 of equity into your house, right?
So you're up $300K.
Yeah, pretty much. So that's buy, rehab, and refinance. Pre-sales, assignment, and complete and flip. So I'm going to a little bit more detail into this. So you buy a $400,000 pre-sale. It's completing in 2 years. 20% down payment. Usually the developers want your down payment within a month, like 5% in the month, and then, no, it's 5% within 10 days, and another 5% within a month, and then another 5% within 6 months, and another 5% after like a year. Something like that. So let's just say they want 20% down payment in the first year. So 80K. You sell for 450,000 right before completion, right before the two-year mark. And then usually developers will charge you a 1-2% assignment fee on the original purchase price, because they, back in the late 2006, 2007, people were just flipping like crazy. And developers were like, I want a cut out of it. So they started charging the 1-2% assignment fee. So let's just say 2% assignment fee is $8,000. Obviously, when you assign it, you use a realtor, and the realtor commissions are about $15,000. So your profit would be $50,000 minus $8,000 minus $15,000 equals $27,000. But obviously, that's how much you make after 2 years. So $27,000 divided by 80, ROI stands for return on investment. The formula is income over investment. Your income is $27,000. Your investment was $80,000. So your profit is about your profit, $27,000 divided by $80,000 is about 34%. But because you're looking at ROI per year, so ROI 34% divided by 2 years is about 17% per year. That's pre-sale assignments with it before the 2 year mark. Post completion means you wait until it completes and then you flip it. So you just add the property transfer tax, 2% minus $2,000 equals $6,000. Property transfer tax, you have to pay it. It's basically, the formula is 2% on the purchase price minus $2,000. So 2% of 400,000 is 8,000 minus $2,000 equals 6,000. So instead of 27 divided by 80, it's 21 divided by 80. So it's 26% or 13% a year. Next. Yeah, go ahead.
In the post completion
yes.
Option,
yeah.
Do you still have to pay the assignment fee to the developer in that situation?
You're right. Okay. Yeah, you don't have to pay the 1%, 1-2% assignment fee on that. So probably a little bit higher. Yeah, you're right. Okay, my favorite topic, cash flow analysis. When I started learning this, it just blew my mind. This is an actual example. Actual is an example, you can buy it today. Okay, $100,000 condo in Abbotsford, 2-bedroom, 1-bath. The mortgage would be 80%, $80,000. Down payment, $20,000. Your expenses, the mortgage payment based on a 2.59% interest is about $360 a month. Your strata fee, exactly, it is $200 a month. Property taxes, about $100 a month. Actually, some of it is actually less, but be conservative, $100 a month. Your home insurance is about $15 a month. Your repairs and maintenance, so let's just put $50 aside in your bank account in case your tenant needs some repairs or maintenance. $50 a month. Let's say it's vacant. So you have to incorporate a vacancy allowance. But I looked up CMHC vacancy allowance in Vancouver, Greater Vancouver, 0.8%. So 0.8% of the rent is 0.8% of $950 is your rent, is $7.60 a month. Property management allowance. So let's say you don't want to drive to Abbotsford to manage your tenant. Could be around 8% to 15% property management, but let's just say 10% of rent, $95 a month. So you want to calculate cash flow, you do net income minus your expenses equals your net income equals your income minus your expenses equals your net income. So your income is 950 minus your expenses, 360 plus 200 plus 100 plus 15 plus 50 plus $7.60 plus 95 equals $122.40 per month. Is that a good number or a bad number?
It's positive.
Yeah, positive. But let's say you got $122 cash flow, positive, but your down payment, let's say this was a $5 million home and your down payment was $1 million. $122 a month, is that good cash flow? Is that good return or not? So you have to calculate return on investment. What was your investment? So let's do $122 a month times 12 equals $1,468. $1,468 divided by, so that's your income. Return ROI, your formula is income over investment. So your investment was $20,000. So $1,468 is your income divided by your investment equals 7.3% cash on cash return. So you put in $20,000 cash, you get $1,500 cash return your ROI is 7.3%. Okay? Pretty good, much better than the banks. So then we talk about cash on cash plus equity. Okay? What this means. So when your tenant, so how it works is this. I explained this to my clients, and this is in chapter 15 of my book. Your tenants, when they pay your mortgage of $360 a month, most people get a mortgage that's blended. Blended means a portion of it goes to principal and a portion of it goes to interest. In the beginning of your mortgage, most usually is about 50-50, approximately. Near the end of your mortgage, most of it is principal. So if 50% of the mortgage goes towards principal, then that should be added towards your return on investment. You don't get it in cash per se, but you get it in terms of equity. Imagine your mortgage was 25 years, all interest only. So no matter what, the tenant never paid down your mortgage, never, just paid the interest. Then you don't own the property, right? But if it goes to blended principal and income, after 25 years, you own the property. So here's how you calculate it. I actually have a spreadsheet that goes into a lot more accuracy into this, but it's about 50%. So let's say 50% of mortgage payment goes towards the principal, which is the mortgage payment is 360 here. So 180 goes towards the principal. So remember our income was $122. $122 a month. Then we add the $180 of equity. And then that's per month, right? So how many per year? How much money is that per year? $3,628 a year divided by your down payment of $20,000. All of a sudden, it's 18.1% return. So, better than your 7.3%. 18.1%. So that's if your property never goes up in value. Let's say it stays the same. But here, cash on cash plus equity plus appreciation. So let's say it goes up 3% a year, which is approximately inflation. Okay, so let's say it goes up asset appreciation of 3%. In this market, condos go up like 10 to 15%, houses 25 to 30. But in a normal market, you're looking at condos maybe 5 to 10% in good areas, maybe like just 5% or 3 to 5% in bad areas. But let's just say 3%. Just to be conservative, 3% on your $100,000 property is $3,000 a year. So you take your $3,628, you add your $3,000 equals $6,628. Your ROI formula, income over investment, $6,600 divided by $20,000 equals a 33.1% ROI return. Questions about that? So this is the more detailed version of how to calculate your cash on cash plus equity, cash on cash plus equity plus appreciation. And that's it for my presentation. If you want to learn more, visit my website, GaryWongRealty.com. A lot of the stuff I talked to you about, it's also on my YouTube channel. I film lots of videos and I just share it.
This talk is going to be on the YouTube.
Yep, this talk will also be on YouTube. You know, it will be available for the public. So the book on Vancouver real estate is the book I wrote as a response to the lack of transparency I saw in the industry. It's my gift to you today. All you need to do is just fill in your name, email, and phone number on my document. Over there, I have a document on my computer, and then we'll do that. But before we end it, we have frequently asked questions. So before you go into questions, one of the questions asked during the break was, how do I search for a good realtor in this market? I talked about it in my YouTube videos, and I get asked that by some reporters based on what's going on in the industry right now. So just to summarize it, like I usually do, make sure the realtor is honest and is fully disclosing stuff. So how do I know? I just ask them questions. Do they look like they're keeping information away from me? Are they not explaining stuff? If I ask them how to explain this form, are they just saying, sign here, sign there? Or are they explaining what the terms mean? Are they explaining what their duties are? Are they explaining their expectations? And are they asking you questions? Those are typical questions to find out if they're like hiding stuff. If a realtor always talks about their commission, let's say they talk about their own commission all the time, then I sort of know what they think about, right? Because what comes out of your mouth is from your heart, what's in your mind, right? So if they always talk about money, their own commission, then I'm like, maybe this guy only cares about their money, right? But if they never talk about commission, then I'm like, this guy's not really disclosing anything. Because as you know, realtors have to disclose how much their brokerages get compensated for their services. So there should be a balance. He shouldn't be talking about, you know, money all the time about how he gets paid, but he also shouldn't be never talking about it, right? That's the other topic. That's the other indication. Are there any red flags? Do they seem like they're trying to press you into doing a deal quickly, right? Are they trying to get you to buy really quickly or sell really quickly? Those are signs too. Like, unless you have explained to him, oh, I need to buy really quickly, then that's the thing. Well, when I work with my clients, I find out their needs and find out what stage they're at. Are they in a hurry to buy, or are they in a hurry to sell? And then if they're in a hurry to sell or hurry to buy, then I'll change my state and serve them accordingly. Let's say they're really just browsing right now, then I would not be on top of them, obviously. I just give them their space and when they're ready, that kind of thing, right? So that's also the thing. Is the realtor really asking you about what needs are important to you, right? That's also important. Is it better to have an experienced realtor or a brand new realtor? Just because you have an experienced realtor, like one who's been in the year for 20 years, doesn't mean they're good. There are realtors who have been in the industry for 20 years. They could have been part-time for the first 10 years, or they could have just kept their license and just did the courses, but they could have, you know, not done a lot of deals. Or even if they did a lot of deals, it doesn't mean they know their stuff. Yes, Cindy.
Since the realtor license is so easy to get, it's not
yes. Yes.
But what do you do when, like, say you're like your friend that you know for like a while, they become a realtor and ask you for help, but you can't obviously refer clients, but you kind of hesitant because he's so new.
Yeah.
You can't refer them like, oh, my friend's gonna ask you to find some home and take care of them. It hesitant because they're new to the industry.
Okay.
How can you help?
How do I do? So when you're new, then if you want to get business, you show the initiative. So I rather have a brand new realtor that shows super initiative, willingness to learn, willingness to ask questions. If they don't know the answer, they find out. They don't just go, I don't know, and that's it. I'd rather have that kind of realtor than one who's been in the industry for 20 years, super lazy, you know, like has a team of people helping you, and they're like, you know, they don't really care if your house sells or not. They're not on top of it. I'd rather have like a go-getter, brand new realtor, doesn't know much, but they're like, go get it, they'll do whatever it takes, they'll like, you know? Yes,
and even, Gary, like, what I kind of view is like, in the city there's like over thousands of realtors.
Yes.
So like, as a realtor, if I see somebody's gonna give me like a free book on Vancouver real estate,
yeah,
right, or they're giving me something for free, I'm like, okay, why? I should just go with yes. this realtor right there.
Yeah,
that's like another thing. Like
that's great. Yeah, offering value, that's really helpful. If it were me, I don't choose a realtor based on like kickbacks, how much money they give back to me. Like that's not important. I care about do they know their stuff. If they don't know their stuff, that's okay because nobody knows everything. Even the 30-year in the industry veterans, they don't know everything about the industry. It's constantly changing. They have to constantly educate. So I don't care if they know everything. I care if they're willing to find the answer, if they're on top of things, if they have integrity. And when everybody says they have integrity, this integrity means to me, you do what you say and you say what you do. So if they say they're gonna call me back, but they don't call me back, they say they're gonna get back to me, but they don't get back to me, then it's like, right? I can see like what kind of person they are, right? So that's another thing. The Yeah, and awards. A lot of, some realtors are like they boast about the awards that they get, and awards, it's one indication of success, but success doesn't mean they're the right realtor for you. So I won some awards, but it's not that important because I know some bad realtors who win awards too. And if you just know a few rich people and you do a couple deals a year, you could win some awards. Doesn't mean they're good at what they do. Yeah, and even if they have the volume too. Let's say they do like 30 deals a year, 40 deals a year. Like I said, it doesn't mean they're good. Like they might be good at closing the sale, but it doesn't mean they're good at providing tailored custom service. Some people, exactly. So what I recommend my clients, interview them, see if they jive. I tell my clients I'm not interested in being a transactional realtor to them. I'm not interested in a one-off deal with them. I'm interested in a lifelong relationship with them. I don't want to just do one deal with them and then disappear, right? Yeah.
And it's good because if somebody's giving me their property address,
yeah,
I can tell them what things are renting for.
Exactly.
Do realtors do the same thing?
To like go and offer free market evaluations?
Yeah.
Yeah. That's a really common tactic. It's been in the industry for years. Yeah. Oh, well, I'll do free market evaluation on your property. It's not hard.
And do comparables.
Yeah, very easy. Like very easy.
Yeah. Insane.
Yeah.
Yeah. Others are just quite stagnant.
Yeah. Yeah. So market evaluation is very common, very easy. So actually, every realtor can do market evaluations. I'd say the good ones know how to do it really quickly. But you know, some people go into in-depth strategy, in-depth numbers, and some don't. But like I said, it's not about the volume, not about the awards, not about the number of years. I want somebody who's honest, who fully discloses, who's in it with me for the long run, who will, you know, tailor their service according to my needs, and they'll look at my long-term goals, and they'll be like, hey, you know what, based on your long-term goals, this isn't a good buy. But if you want to buy it, I'll help you buy it. But based on your long-term goals. So I usually talk to my clients, what's your two-year goal, five-year goal, 10-year goal? Because if they're like, oh, Gary, I really care about cash flow and all this stuff, and then they're like, no, but I really want to buy these $5 million properties. I'm like, but it doesn't really match your criteria for cash flow. And they're like, oh, I just want to buy those $5 million. Then I'm like, okay, well, at least I educated them. So I want somebody at least like who will educate me and watch out for my best interest. But whether I listen to them or not, that's my responsibility, right? As a, like if I'm, you know, if I'm hiring a realtor. Thanks guys for watching my video. Please subscribe and share with your friends. Email me if you have any more questions. Thank you.